Hello. I've just said the first Vespers for the feast of the invention of the Holy Cross. And during that liturgy, I made a commemoration of St. Athanasius because the second Vespers of St. Athanasius coincides with the first Vespers of the Holy Cross. I also have recently been to our diocesan synod in Painter's Forstall, in our cathedral there. And it was a lovely occasion. It usually is. In times past, we have had one or two difficult characters who have been determined to stand up against the what our church is trying to do, and try and turn it into something that they want it to be. Now you may ask, well, how's it? You're a tiny church. Aren't you trying to do the same thing? Aren't you just like some of these awkward people who just want their own way all the time? And it really depends on what you're trying to do. The Christian life is about the search for God, and it's a strange search because from the outset we've already found him. Because the Christian life begins with God. And so we spend our lives trying to work out who God is and who we are. Now, St. Athanasius has the same problem because he lives at a time where people are trying to work out who God is and who they are. And St. Athanasius is noted for being almost a lone voice against a lot of Christians who followed the teaching of Arius, that our Lord was a created being, the first among creation, but not created nonetheless. And Athanasius struggled against this. And the phrase Athanasius contra mundum, Athanasius against the world, is quite well known. He's exiled all over the place. Finally, he manages to get through 46 years of being the Bishop of Alexandria. And his writings still speak to us today. He it is who wrote the famous phrase that God became man so that we could become gods or beings like God. Again, back to 1 John 3, 2. The life of St. Athanasius is filled with an earnest desire to know God and to let people know God and to fight for that, for the truth about God to come through. And we, as in the Anglican Catholic Church, we're trying to do the same. Ours is a strange little existence because we exist precisely because we shouldn't. We exist because there are divisions in the church. We exist because the church there is this decision. Do we allow modern, progressive teaching to change the way that we do church? And we in the Anglican Catholic Church say no. Man does not have the ability to alter the truth. Why? Because the truth is eternal. Jesus said that he is the way, the truth, and the life. And so we take a stand. And in taking a stand, we accept the burden of a cross. All Christians have to accept the burden of the cross. Because the cross, well, it's a big deal. Because it's in accepting our own death. It's accepting our own struggles in life. It's accepting the blood, the sweat, the tears, the devastation of being human. And it's accepting this on the faith of God. We believe God, and we believe what he tells us to be, tells us that he is. The individuals, the difficult individuals that we have dealt with in the past, usually have got one thing in mind and try and convince the church of that way. What's different about their stand and ours? Well, ours is very much about unity in Christ, in the truth. It's about struggling with truth. And it's those who think that they've got it made, that they understand all of Christian theology. It's those who think that their position is right, and who don't have the humility to accept the possibility that there is something wrong. It's those folk that cause the trouble and damage the church. On the other hand, if we have the doctrine of the faith of God, and it's revealed to us through Holy Scripture, through the Church Fathers and the Church Tradition, and through reason, then you notice that that's not just one person's opinion. You notice that that is a confluence of the eyewitness testimony of the apostles, of the understanding of the Church Fathers, a continuation of that teaching. It's not one person. It's not one person's ideal. It's not one person's opinion. And it's that we are trying to preserve. Because progressivism, the modern way of changing things, the changing the faith to adapt to the times, that's like these difficult people who try to force their opinions on us. It's like trying to work with people who say, no, this is the right way, this is what the Times says. And we have to say, well, no. And we have to fall back upon our own littleness and accept the great body of work that is the Catholic Church. It sounds strange, but Christian doctrine isn't complete, and it is complete. There's a contradiction there. What do I mean by that? Well, in the sense that every Christian who's ever lived, has access to the same truth. That's true. The truth is the truth throughout eternity. However we experience that truth in our own times. And how do we know that it's the truth? We know that it's the truth by reference back in church tradition. And St. Athanasius is there with us because he too is referring back to Scripture, he's referring back to the Fathers, he's referring back to the first Christians who know that Jesus is God, that he is not a creation, he is not a creature. He participates in creation itself, together with the Father and the Holy Ghost. And so he has nothing. There's nothing else he can do. He sticks in humility to what the Church is saying, not what the age is saying, not what the individual opinions might be. Experience is important in our Christian life because it gives us things to test against the Catholic faith, and it helps us to know what the truth is. That's how we grow as Christians. Our experience in life is what gets tested. Not Christian doctrine gets tested against us, it's we that gets tested against Christian doctrine. And that Christian doctrine, it sounds like something purely intellectual. It isn't, it is spiritual as well, and that involves spiritual growth. We have to grow in the spirit, more so than in the head. But, as St. Anselm says, you've got to have faith that seeks understanding. Because that's the human beings that we are. It means that sometimes we can have to have a lonely road because we are sticking to the principles, to the Catholic faith is sticking to it, even when loads and loads of people are not. As it says, Psalm 91, I think, though thousands languish and fall beside thee, and tens of thousands around thee perish, it shall not come nigh thee. The same is true with the Christian faith. We hold on to it even if tens of thousands fall away from it. God forbid. So God bless you. God bless you if you are struggling with the Christian faith at this moment in time. There's something that's fundamentally upsetting you about it. God bless you that your wrestle, your struggle, the pain that you suffer, may be the same part of your cross that you bear that will bring you to face to face with Christ himself. God bless you if you are plagued with people who are trying to force their opinions on you. God bless you and know that there is this great big body of work done by Christians before you to help you through this. And God bless you that your experience of life may be shaped by the spiritual growth in Christ, that you may stand before his seat in glory and reign with him in eternity. God bless you, and please pray for me.